Previously on The Code, Life with the Mariners.
We implemented a new playing system this year. Arnie wanted to re-challenge the players and the staff.
Matty, Tommy, congratulations. Socceroo selection.
The Mariners have given me an opportunity to play, and I'm very thankful for that.
You're great 1v1, so you can still face them, you can bang and shoot.
How you going, champ? What's your name? Evan, nice to meet you, mate. I'm signing for you.
We've got to put your belt on. Here, big belt for Patrick. Woo-hoo. New belt. He's getting on in years.
That's where it was important with the players getting out in the community and the players becoming heroes to the local kids.
I know.
The kids have the final say. If they want to go back for friends and study and whatever, then we go back. If they want to stay, I'm happy to stay. I love it.
He's always willing to listen. He's always willing to give advice. And I think that's what helps make him the coach that he is.
Out! Oh, yep.
When the A-League first started, it was an interesting time because I don't think football on the Central Coast was huge.
It is Bowich driving it, and he's beaten Bolton again.
As a rugby league man, I actually come to the stadium for the Mariners matches, and I see rugby league, I see rugby union supporters, I see AFL supporters, because they want their own team, and they've embraced the Mariners.
Same as the David Beckham thing. As a tall people, it doesn't matter if we don't get them. All of a sudden, the Central Coast's all over the world, press, TV, media.
We're delayed probably about an hour and a half at the moment. Could be a lot longer. It's 2 days before Christmas, so all the boys want to get home.
Give me 4 minutes, a bit of rest, okay. Another 4 minutes, a rest.
Stay down, yeah. Let us deal with it, because hey, if I've got to deal with you guys jumping, then okay. I can't move there, okay?
You imagine their crowds if they were winning every game, but like, they're still getting 20 plus. It's good for you, Maka, you'll be playing for Napoli next year.
Not going that low.
I hope they work as hard as they can. They try their hardest.
We use the recovery session to assess how everyone's come up from the game. We're blessed with a beautiful environment here, so on a nice day we try to get here as often as possible after a game.
You know, a few of the boys helped out. We painted the walls, we got the whiteboard up to get things a little bit more organised, we got some carpet down, and we've made it at home.
The players get there an hour and a half before the game, so I get there about an hour and a half before they get there to make sure that everything's set up.
Well, the atmosphere is electric. Well, there'll be no offside here. It's a back pass, and McBreen has got his second of the evening.
One thing I was very happy with, huh? I thought that we kept Ono real quiet.
I've told you many times, no one can touch us. The only thing that can undo us is ourselves.
How the hell wasn't that a foul?
Grant, you can go, please.
Oh, right. What
for?
Up to the set.
Jeez, I tell you what, you got thin skin, you boys.
Was it because of last Sunday playing in the heat? Was it because maybe 37 degrees on your day off knocked you about because you're out doing things, the beach and et cetera?
You know you're going to have mates here that you'll have for the rest of your life because you're so close and you know so much about each other and spend a lot of time with each other.
Probably you, bro.
It probably all started at the start of this season, something that a couple of boys we had, and then it just built on from there, you know, new player each day, and next week it'll be another player join on, and it's just a matter of coming in and remembering all the handshakes.
We are the Mariners! The mighty, mighty Mariners! The mighty.
Over 9 months of filming, the Code TV series followed the Central Coast Mariners and their loyal tribe of players, partners, members and supporters through 27 rounds of A-League football, allowing the TV audience an exclusive insight to the culture and personalities of this overachieving organisation. But one more story remained to be told as the team ventured into the final series, a place where hearts are broken and legacies created.
Well, it's dawned a beautiful day here in Brisbane today, and for the first time I can remember, this proud sporting city has turned orange, and it's helped transform it into a football town. Of course, we're talking about the A-League Grand Final tonight between the Roar and the Mariners. If there was any proof needed that this league has made giant strides into the hearts and minds of the Australian sporting public, it's a sellout tonight, and we're certainly hoping for a magnificent game between these two great teams.
the corner. Back into the danger zone. There's a beanie. It's in the back of the net from Adam Kwasnik. The Mariners have scored.
Bernie Abini headed it back across goal, and I was sort of right place at the right time, and I sort of took a touch, which was a bit heavy due to the heavy legs, and then I just put my foot out there and it actually hit the back of the net. And I just thought, wow.
This could seal it for the Mariners. Great save by Theokritos first time. Kwasnik steers it up, and Bozanic surely clinches the championship for the Central Coast Mariners.
Ollie just had to slot it into the side of the corner and beat the keeper, and he did. And you know, everyone was in raptures and chased Ollie down the field and big stacks on. And we thought we had it in the bag.
2-0 up. Eric Partilou walked past me and he goes, "Oh, well done, Quaz. Game over." And I said, "Mate, it's not over. Not over yet." And that definitely sticks with me. Every time memories come back of that grand final.
In that moment, obviously you have those feelings of fear and anxiety and what do we have to do to try to shift this momentum?
You know, we still thought we were going to win the game. I know they scored the first one, there's a couple of minutes left, and even when they won the corner for their second goal, the boys were very calm. It sounds surprising, but we're very calm. We thought, just clear the danger and the game's over.
And it goes.
You know, I think you're hoping and praying that the boys can just find enough, mental strength and physical stamina, I guess, to stroke the ball into the back of the net and outwit the goalkeeper. But it really is in the lap of the gods by that stage.
Enrique against Ryan. It's all on this. Enrique scores! Brisbane are the champions!
I think it was about 2 hours of silence. It was, no one spoke.
You know, to have it taken away like that was a little bit surreal. It just didn't feel like I was alive at that time.
It was something that, I don't ever want to experience again, being 2-0 up in the grand final with 4 or 5 minutes to go. But, it is what it is. And, we will never forget that feeling. As Arnie said, don't forget what that felt like to lose one, because that's what it takes to win one.
Squad game as well.
Yeah. Are we going to announce the captain?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep. So just a welcome to keep people interested.
Can't believe you.
Who's the captain?
I don't know. No idea. But who's the man?
I know who the man is. How did you get that? How did you get it? Come on! I told you you're gonna be a man, didn't I?
How did you get a captain?
Same way you got me.
Morning, ladies and gentlemen. If you could mingle over this way. I'm the muscular guy on the stage. Stop laughing. We've started a group where we meet with the fans once a month to just get some feedback so we can have a great game experience, and hopefully this season we can go one step further than we've done before and win a grand final. So that's the goal, and without you guys, we can't do that. Del Piero was signing for Sydney. He's huge for the league, huge for everybody. Look, when we played in the 3rd of November, the place will be packed. So we're going to benefit from him. As football fans, you want Sydney to be successful because then they'll bring more punters up to our bit and we get more money off them. So we're very open to take money off anybody.
The culture and everything about this club is unbelievable. And, you know, when you have new players like Melo said, Jossie, who's played all around the world, and now Nick Montgomery that comes in, and so from day one they say it's like, you know, a family club.
Obviously it's a great honour to be captain of any team, but to be captain of the Mariners...
Chairman Peter Turnbull and former head coach Laurie McKenna joined Graham Arnold and his squad as they primed the gathered fans for the announcement of the Mariners' captain for the coming season.
So I'm proud to announce that the captain of the Central Coast Mariners this season is the foundation player, John Hutchinson.
Thank you. Hopefully you enjoyed the day, enjoyed the season.
While Hutch is a popular choice as leader, his deputy isn't so popular as a speaker.
Sit down, relax. We got till 2 o'clock, I think. No, it's a great honour to be Fires captain, and especially after Hutch, he's here the longest, 7 years together with Kwasnik, I think, and he's a Mariner, a true and a worthy Mariner. So we all decided. I had a talk with Arnie and with a few of the staff, and we all decided that Hutch was a great captain. And, he would be the one to lead the Mariners forward, so thanks for being a Fires captain, and hope to see you everywhere at the stadium. Thanks.
In typical Mariners style, the leadership is a shared privilege.
It wasn't only us two, it was Daniel McBreen, was one of the older players, Nick Montgomery, Joshua Rose. So there were a lot of players that picked up from there. We didn't have one leader in the game, we had five or six. That showed the example how to go into a game, what to do on and off the park and everything. So, and we became even stronger, connected to each other, and so the link was easily made. And man, it's been from there. Looking back, it's been an amazing year.
We had a good pre-season, we won a lot of matches, and we had maintained a lot of the players. It was basically the same squad with the addition of a couple of new faces.
I think with any pre-season, everything's a little bit unknown. You know, you play pre-season games and you're always thinking, oh, are we holding a little bit back, or are other teams holding a little bit back? And it's not until that first game that you really get a proper measuring stick of where you're at.
Save, Davey.
Saints, kick that ball, $10. Yes. $10 for Sainsbury. After you kicked it.
The first game of any football season is a journey into the unknown. Even more so if your opening round opponent has no history at all.
I think it was a bit of an awkward game, to be honest. They're brand new in the league. No one was really expecting much from them, and we were coming off the back of a Premier's plate. So it was a bit difficult of a game to go into and try and get your head around it, I guess. We went out there nervous, obviously, because it's the first game of the season.
There was a lot of hype behind the Wanderers, obviously. They just signed Shinji Ono and all the press was about them, but I think we were expected to beat them. But it was a bit of a strange match, because it was a nil all draw the opening night of the season, and it didn't really give too much away about what either team was going to achieve that year.
The two teams soon became the story of the season, with the Mariners being pushed hard to retain the Premier's plate.
To have the results we did at home, you know, to make Blue Tongue such a fortress, and to finish second was, you know, a great, probably reflection of our season.
I thought we probably deserved to be the premiers. You know, I think overall our performance throughout the whole season was exceptional, and I think we were a bit unlucky towards the end, you know, with a few games, which probably cost us the premiership. But overall, I think we should be proud of what we did.
We had a bit of a hiccup against West Sydney at home, and they beat us 1-0. And we couldn't catch them again after that, but our performances were still good.
Beautiful to watch, especially second half. Some of the goals, combination play, and that was first class. Again, the home record is crucial. Yep, so 9 games, 8 wins, 1 draw. It's unbelievable, fantastic.
Overall, we did very well. You start new goals, and that's what we did. You know, when we realised that we couldn't get that premiership, we refocused and we got new goals, and we pushed on from there.
Despite leading the competition for much of the year and a last round win against the Heart, the Wanderers relegated the Mariners to second place.
I think if the season had stopped there and there wasn't a final series, despite many people around here being vocal about the, you know, the value of the final series rather than the winner of the league, I think for us it would have felt unfulfilling. I think we felt over the 27 games we were probably the best team in the league.
I think it was the match that we played the Wanderers at Blue Tongue in the pouring rain, and we dominated the match, but we ended up losing 1-0. After that game, we decided to sit down, and Arnie had a good chat to us, and we decided then to change our goals.
We lost our own destiny, where the, you know, we had to rely on other teams to do something for us, which didn't eventuate.
We began then preparations for the championship. As much as we didn't want to let the premiership go, he told us that, you know, it's probably out of our reach now, and to set new goals. So it was from that day on, I think the championship was definitely the number one priority.
Sometimes complacency can creep in. We'd had a good run of results, and then we lost to West Sydney. And I think that sort of changed the team going into the finals, because they knew that, you know, something could go wrong.
We went into that game and we had everybody to choose from. We were very prepared, and I think the inner belief was starting to grow. Melbourne, you know, have always found it difficult to come to Blue Tongue, and we got the job done.
Bowich still plenty forward for the Mariners. Including Svansbeek, who flicked it through for Stojoski on target. Nathan Coe getting down smartly to his left. Can he find that corridor of uncertainty, Michael McGlinchey? He's gone deep instead. Drop here for Abini, and Sainsbury trying to poke it towards goal, and then blasted with real power wide by Daniel McBreen. Montgomery looks for the switch, and McGlinchey is in behind Jason Carrier. McBreen! And the block is made by Adrian Layat. Now Bowich gets a cut inside the fullback. Selesky's back to cover. Abini in space. It's Bernie Abini. And too much elevation.
Macca, the season just gone, just had that touch where everything he touched turned to goals. He was in the right place at the right time, but also he made his own luck as well. That was one of the most important goals going into that sort of final series. When the half yard of space opened up for Macca, he didn't hesitate and he struck a great shot past Nathan Coe.
Sit down, have a rest. Sit down, breathe up. Transition is what they're waiting to get us on. If they break on us and you can get close enough, no one's out of yellow yet. But what I want you to do in the next 50 minutes, huh? Because I'll be 3 minutes extra time, is stay playing the way that you always play. Keep the distractions. Keep the ball moving. Play with confidence, because it's fantastic out there.
Yeah. Come on, let's go. Concentrate on, we'll stay switched on, one to the end.
Yep. Yep.
Good boy.
Come on, boys. Switch on, right to the f***ing end. Come on.
Keep working hard, talk to each other.
Still a long way to go in this semi-final. The Mariners had the advantage and they start in the second half with real purpose.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Ah, it's the f***ing Rosie, we're gone. Jesus f***ing me. What the f***?
Now Selesky looking to release Archie Thompson. Thompson, oh, he didn't really get a hold of it.
Duke, let's go.
Despite the lead, there are some nervous moments. And fresh legs are called for from the bench.
With my position, I sort of just watch, the defenders and what they're doing and, you know, their weaknesses as well. Obviously analysing the game and sort of where we can probably, like, do better if we need it.
Quicker! Shift it!
And Mitchell Duke's impact is immediate.
McBreen finding some space and holding off the defender. Here's Mitch Duke. Duke!
Come on, come on!
And then, with only seconds to go, one Mariners season is about to end.
I just remember going to block a ball down the line from, I think it was Mark Milligan, the Victory captain, and I'd try and block the ball, 50 times a game, but, as I put my foot out, he went to clear the ball and sort of he's followed through with his foot and hit mine.
If the Mariners do go through, Nick Montgomery will play no parts, the same as Yusuf Hirsi for the Wanderers.
He's been sort of a rock all season. In there beside Hutch, and we've sort of all struck up a good relationship and partnership on the pitch. And first, I just thought of the final, and that it's going to affect the team, but obviously it's going to affect him personally as well. So it was just a massive blow for him and the team.
For me, a whole world of emotions came that moment because, I played over 400 games in England, and throughout my career, and I'd never received a red card.
It wasn't a malicious tackle; it was more of a clumsy tackle. And for him to miss out on a huge game the week after, with only a couple of minutes to go, but we had to, we still had to hold on in those last couple of minutes with 10 men. I'm always wary of a Melbourne Victory or an Ange Postecoglou coach team. They're very resilient. Ange has shown in the past with Upper Brisbane that they're strong right through the 95th minute, and you've got to stay on your game the whole way through. And obviously, it was a tense moment right outside the edge of the box.
Down he goes, free kick on the edge of the D.
I think it was a foul. To be fair, I gave away a foul, and I just thought, oh God, hopefully either he doesn't have a good kick or Matty Ryan or someone can pull something out the bag. And you just always got in the back of your head. I think we did anyway that season, that we knew what could happen in the last sort of minutes of games, and we just didn't want anything like that to go again.
This is it, man.
You've got to jump.
Last kick of the game.
Morning!
Last kick of the game. Come on.
Morning!
I remember driving to the game and just saying to my wife, I'm not ready for the season to be over yet. Whereas at the same stage last year, I was knackered, I was out on my feet.
One more nervous moment for the Mariners.
Hutch, get out!
That's it! That's it! It's f***ing over!
through to an unprecedented fourth final as Victory miss out and Ange Postecoglou suffers his first defeat in finals football in 16 years.
Probably felt not as jubilant as you might think. I think certainly I take it one game at a time. I think winning that semi-final was a reward for the good performances that we sustained throughout the year. I think it was just a good reward to make the grand final.
Everybody knew what the jobs were and everybody also knew where Victory was vulnerable during that game, and the score was only 1-0, but I think we dominated them from first to last minute, and we never let them come into the game.
Overall, it was a fantastic game of football. I thought Melbourne Victory were very good tonight. You know, I think that everyone's been saying that they've been down for the last 6 weeks and haven't been at their best, but I thought tonight they were at their best, and it's nice to beat Victory when they're at their best, and I thought our performance tonight was outstanding. Tactically, the boys carried out the game plan perfect, and you know, against Victory, you know, when you try to go through the middle and they pinch the first ball, you know, that's when they're lethal. And so it was important that we went wide tonight, and I thought McGlinchey was fantastic. Unfortunately, I think that might be their last game on this field for a lot of those for some of those players. I think that they've got agents knocking on the door. And I think you might see that they'll be heading off. It's already been our year, in my view. You know, the players have done a fantastic job. 3 years in a row, top two, only club ever. 3 years in a row, more than 50 points. Scored more goals than anyone. So the season has already been a massive success.
First of all, boys, congratulations. Two best teams deserve to be in the grand final, and we are the best team. Make no mistake about it. You play like that. And you play like you've done in the past, they can't compete with us. So first of all, a big congratulations. If there's one little negative, don't stop playing. The last 10, 12, 15 minutes, we stop playing. And when you do that, you give them the ball back and you give them opportunities. You give them opportunities, keep playing. Keep playing to our structures. Play out the 95 minutes and move the ball around. So, this week, I don't care because it's a grand final, nothing changes. It's a normal week. Tomorrow, recovery. Tuesday off. And then me and Clarkie will sit and we'll come up with a program. We're not going to Sydney the day before the game. We get the bus down as normal. It's a normal game of football. So, all you can do is make a big deal out of the game and it'll affect your performance. So, one more game. One more game.
Keeping the routine as normal as possible includes celebrating birthdays. This morning, it is the turn of team assistant Paul McNabb, who was given the usual Mariners treatment.
Big mosquito. Big mosquito. Big mosquito, Central Coast.
I don't want anyone, if I can ask, I don't want anyone to read papers. Use papers this week. Don't go on the internet. Don't start reading blogs. The media have a job to do, and the job that they'll want to bring up this week is the past. The Mariners, the grand finals that we haven't won. For me, that's all history. It's about the present. And the present's on Sunday, and that's what we can control.
You will get 4 Category A tickets. You can purchase more, and they will be in that category. If you buy more Category A tickets, they will all be together. If you buy Category B tickets, then they're obviously not going to be with the Category A. I don't know. I've sent you an email with all the form on it, with all the details, all the ticketing prices. If you want extra tickets, it has to be in by 4 o'clock this afternoon.
You looking forward to the game on the weekend? Who's going to win?
Mariners.
Trick question, I think. Do you want me to sign that? I like that. Do you wear this to the match?
That's really cool.
So today we're here at Tuggera Westfield Shopping Centre. Just sort of meeting and greeting the fans and coming to sign a session. We've got three or four days out from the game. We're just sort of trying to get the promotion, get the community involved. Today we've got a big signed jersey. A jersey above the Westfield Tuggera. And just trying to get the community involved and then get everyone excited for the game.
Ready?
The extra commitments of grand final week have the potential to mentally drain the players, but previous experience guides the team in the right direction.
I think we dealt with it a lot more, myself personally, a lot easier because we've been through it before as a team, and obviously suffering that loss to Brisbane, it sort of strengthened us as a group and a unit.
One!
Awesome, guys. Sounded great.
Grand final week is something that I hadn't experienced before, but I think I was lucky on a personal point of view that the actual team and the club had been through that experience a few times before, and the coaching staff and the senior players made the week as normal as possible.
2 minutes.
There you go.
Look, I tried to let the boys enjoy the week as much as possible. I tried to be more relaxed than I was during the season. The players don't need to be told it's a big game. It's a special game, they already know that. I tried to keep the energy in their legs for the game because, there was going to be a lot of mental emotion around the game.
How much have you seen this place evolve?
The way we play has changed from day one when you come in. So it's great to see how well we've gone in the last three seasons. And that's just one more to go.
Inclement weather all over New South Wales has forced a change in schedule, with the team heading to Sydney the day before, giving the diehards a chance to say good luck in person.
It was a normal pre-match morning. To me, everything seemed relaxed and the atmosphere was fantastic. The boys were joking around like normal, and fortunately for us, we were staying in the city, so we got to go for a lovely walk. Up near the Opera House.
I think leading up to a game like that, you shouldn't change anything really. Just, what I did was just keep my routine the same as I've always done, I don't think you should change anything just because it's a big game. If you keep everything the same as usual, then you should get, the same result leading into the game.
Smile. Yeah, my name is Dominic. I've been living on the Central Coast for 33 years, and I'm proud to be a Central Coast Mariners supporter from day one. I'm of Italian background. The one thing I missed on the Central Coast was the ability to follow some good soccer, good football. And when the Central Coast Mariners were created, for me, it was a dream come true. And I think that the Central Coast Mariners have been great in creating a team spirit, community, sense of community, belonging that didn't exist before. Having been in four grand finals, and I've been to each and every one of them, and they've all been one more exciting than the other. And I think that today will be probably the pinnacle, the most exciting one of the lot, because we're going to win today.
Oh, I'm sure we'll win today. I think we should have beaten them when we played them up here before. And surely we can kick penalties if we get one or two and score from them this time. But no, I think we'll win today. Our players are playing very well.
The Yellow Army descends on Moore Park, confident but not arrogant. History is against them today, but it does little to dampen spirits.
this is an amazing fairy tale. I well remember the day coming out, the announcement that there would be the team, the Wanderers. So it's great to be here today, and I know that the crowd is just going to have a wonderful, wonderful day.
It's an honour, you know, to lead this team out in the club. It's been a great club to me. You know, and the boys have been fantastic this season, and to lead them out to battle is one they'll always treasure.
Is part of your job today, the two of you, to keep Shinji Ono quiet?
Of course it is, you know. Shinji's Shinji's a great player, and you know, if we let him have any space, he's going to hurt us. So, you know, of course that's our job today, and if he scores, you know who to blame.
While the noise in the stadium reaches a deafening level, the mindset in the inner sanctum is measured and calm.
You know, the atmosphere was pretty relaxed. I think Arnie did a good job in keeping it, you know, relaxed and happy. And we basically took our mind off the game until, you know, a few minutes before kickoff, really.
And as the football world focuses on Australia, team manager Rick Catty has problems of a more practical nature.
Fingers, you tell me if that's flat. Not flat, but just a bit soft. I don't think it's flat, though. That's what I was trying to explain to you last time.
The thing is, you can't put more. If you put too much air in it,
yeah, it's rock
goes
hard.
Out of shape as well.
Yeah.
So.
I must admit to noticing one thing on grand final day in the crowd, and that was Patrick's family, actually. I saw the banner behind the goal.
6 minutes, okay.
And I thought to myself, you know, it'd be great to see Patrick score up that end in his final game.
Strike, Millay. Yes, Bernie!
My wife was there, my son, with my mum and dad and all her family. I had a few mates travel from Gippsland to come up just to see the game and see me lead the team out, and it was something that I'll never forget as we're walking out next to an old Mariner, Michael Bouchet.
Set, Benny boy.
So away we go for the 8th Hyundai A-League Grand Final. The Wanderers have the majority of the backing in the stands, Andy Harper, but many of the experts are backing the Mariners today. Are you among them?
Well, I am, Simon. I think the injury cloud over two or three Western Sydney Wanderers is what might swing it against them. It's going to be a very, very tight game, very physical game.
Come up!
Pressure on the ball.
Well done. Good. Come on.
Stay strong. That's the one. Off you go, Paige.
Go on. Rip it. 1v1.
With a bobble. What's a bobble? What's a bobble? And Mikey was in. If he played the ball square, look. Oh,
good job, linesman. Good job.
Good boys. Good. We're getting into a rhythm.
Much like the opening rounds of a boxing bout, both teams fumble nervously to find a rhythm.
Good, Patrick, open up. Millay, you've got to be looking to get him behind. That's the one. That's the one you're in. Go on, son. Go on, son. Get in. Oh! He's done everything right.
I had the ball at the back and I was had my head up and I was just looking for a few options, and I seen the defenders were caught a little bit square and Millet made a great run, so I thought I'd just try my luck and zing a ball down to him.
The keeper came out and I was there before and I tried to lob him, which I did successfully, but unfortunately the ball was just a few inches too long and hit the crossbar and went over.
That's the thing, you've got to look to get him behind like that. They're vulnerable. Yeah, they're vulnerable, it's perfect. Kovic was deep, so he's not sweeping the back line well.
Who's going short? Where's Bernie?
Hey, yeah, Mikey.
The ebb and flow of grand final football allows for moments of relentless attack to change instantly to scrambling defence.
Look here!
Hey, f***ing switch on!
And despite dominant Mariners' pressure, the Wanderers strike.
What the f***?
Where's Pedge going?
What happened to the short corner? Someone's supposed to be on the edge to take Ono in. It's not too high! Not too high! Not too high!
If he stays flat, Bridge has to come to him. Poliak has to go to Hutch. Bernie, Cole has to come in.
Lynch is caught. Whipped in towards Stojowski at the near post. There was appeals from the Mariners fans there for an infringement. Cross comes in towards Sainsbury.
Sainsbury's near miss is the final action assistant coach Phil Moss will witness from the box. And as he returns to the bench, a familiar battle cry echoes through Allianz Stadium.
I've been in big stadiums where the atmosphere for World Cups and Olympic Games, a fantastic atmosphere, but that was right up there with them, and West Sydney Wanderers supporters were brilliant that day, the noise that they made. But, you know, of course I have to commend the Mariners supporters. They made a lot of noise behind the goals and behind the bench. And, you know, our players definitely could hear our supporters. And it was overall, it was a wonderful occasion. And, you know, it's just a great spectacle for the A-League.
Oh! Oh, Bernie.
Set the slide.
Good, Bernie!
Well done,
Burn! Grand final day was something special. That pitch probably hadn't seen noise like it for club sport of any kind, I don't think, in Australia. And our Mariners fans that travelled down might have been outnumbered in size, but they certainly competed pound for pound well above their weight, which is symbolic of the club.
He should have fallen over. Once he got touched, he should have just gone down.
To find the rawest emotion at any football game, you need not look much further than the bench, where different rules of etiquette apply.
I think they're sniffing for one corner to drive the ball straight to Cole.
You know, the key is that if something's on your mind, to speak your mind on the bench.
Just watch Sturge. Like when it comes across, he's working back onto us.
You know, the final decision rests with Arnie, and, you know, we certainly hold decorum on the bench.
Oh, no! Oh, no! Hey! F*** off!
Jay, tell the boys to settle down a bit.
We want to get the best out of every single player on the field. And then during the game, allow them to play to the best of their abilities.
Hey! Got his arms around it! Lean on his back! He's cuddling him as he's receiving it. Oh, f***ing give it!
Go on, Mikey.
With legs getting heavy and minds wandering to half-time, a promising shot on goal is followed by risky defence. And then, with time almost up in the first half, a Dutchman breaks the deadlock.
I walked up to the 80-yard box. I saw Dino Crashinger picking me up again, and he was just one, maybe a half a metre too late. The ball was coming in perfectly high, about two and a half metres. Just really emotional, but really happy in that moment, and that's why it's such a great thing to have as a memory.
Yeah! Come on! Come on! You picked it.
During the week, he actually said to me jokingly, I've kept it for the last one. He said, watch it. He says, I'll get one in the grand final. I said, well, let's hope so. The delivery from McGlinchey was perfect, and the timing of the run from Patrick was spot on. And, you know, it was a great to score just before halftime and go in at halftime 1-0 up.
Advice from the bench is to stay focused, and then a moment of rare good fortune for the Mariners prevents a disaster.
Oh my God, mate. My God. That was close. Jesus Christ. Yeah, but he didn't move his hand. Look, me. That's a whole hand.
I remember they've all gone up from their crowd and just thinking, you automatically just look at the referee and see what he's going to do, and he'd sort of waved it off, and I just thought, God, this could be sort of our day. One of the ones that you think we could go and do this now.
Seeing on the sideline is Patrick always cabs his and he doesn't know what to do, right? With Mikey in the pocket there like that, he's staying inside to try and block that pass, which means Rosie is getting level and free a lot.
We tried to keep it nice and relaxed because our performance in the first half was very good. Our first aim of that day was to keep a clean sheet.
Yeah, he said just keep doing the same, you know, keep playing football. I think we were 1-0 up at that stage, and for us to go out and try and protect that lead would have just been suicide. So he just wanted us to keep doing what we were doing. But overall, he was quite happy with the first half, and he just wanted us to keep pushing forward and to get that killer goal, I think.
He goes to the pitch, Bridges off onto him.
Graham Arnold's message carries as much mental application as it does physical, with a touch of motivational as well.
Go out as Mariners, come back as
champions. Come on, boys. Come on, come on, come on.
Mikey!
McGlinchey, this would sit for him. Good strength by Cressinger. Oh, and then he's tripped blatantly by McGlinchey, who becomes the first player to go into Peter Green's notebook in the grand final. Quick feet, good delivery to Bridges waiting, had a swing at it.
That's exactly the picture.
Mack has made it across.
Yeah. Mikey just has to go the runner.
He has to. Maka made it to Moy then.
Go with Polly.
Just go with the fullback.
It drops for Ono on the volley. And he can't hit the target.
Go on, Maka. Make it a fight. Well done, Maka. That's all right.
They were so dominant in the first half, but certainly they've allowed the Wanderers back into the game.
Sojoski just went in the ball to run across him, and Sojoski, oh! That could have perhaps been the clincher for the Mariners. They'll work it back out to Shinji Ono. Rutgers are going to make a substitution shortly. Ono into the path of Shannon Cole. Deep towards Kressinger, and it's tipped over the bar by Matt Ryan.
The Mariners, through a cautious protection of their 1-0 lead, have let the Wanderers force their way back into the game. And as 42,000 look on, or look the other way, a handball is about to shape Mariners' history forever.
It was on my side of the penalty box, and I was at the far end on the bench, and I didn't actually see it hit his hand, but the reaction from Daniel McBroom straight away was a handball, and we were fortunate that day because they could have easily had a handball on Pej Bojic straight after we scored.
Maka created the penalty himself because he got the ball and wrestled himself through, I think, two defenders and got himself in the yard box and created the penalty for himself. As soon as the whistle went and he appointed the penalty, we at the back we were just, yes, this has to be the one.
Yes.
I looked at Mike's reaction and he was screaming for it, so I thought, we've got a good chance here. And then when they gave the penalty, it's just one of the ones that I thought, God, we could go 2-0 up here, and we've all obviously we've done it before. And I thought it was a massive penalty, massive pressure, and the way the sort of penalties had been going for us that season wasn't too great.
You know, we all knew that Maka would take it, and you know, leading up to the grand final, he was pretty confident.
No one protested. It was very quick, a very quick process after the referee awarded the penalty, and within probably 15 seconds, Daniel already had the ball on the spot.
I think it was again fitting that it was Maka, you know, the senior pro, the journeyman who had the season of his life. Had the opportunity to put the final nail in the coffin of the grand final.
Hutch! Tell Sainz he's got to watch that ball through the middle, bud. Tell Sainz he has to watch that ball through the middle, yeah? It could f***ing kill us, mate. It's on for young and old in behind, bud.
This is such a big moment.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just tell me.
You're here.
Thought this is it, this is the moment, and I've kind of closed my eyes, and I knew Arnie was as well, and he's put it top corner, couldn't have been a better pen.
It was obviously a key moment in the game, and there was a feeling that we deserved that moment, and there was a feeling that it was meant to be. 2-0 leads can be dangerous, but there was no way the boys were letting that one slip this time.
I remember turning around to Mossy on the bench and saying, this is a massive moment. If we get this, then it's a matter of getting through the next 15, 20 minutes to get us home. And I think the vision shows me with my head down, I didn't watch it and I didn't see it until I saw it on the replay.
Yeah! Woo-hoo!
Stay compact, stay calm. Stay compact, stay calm.
Off though, is it?
No,
he just talked to him before.
While the main actors of the Mariners' story occupy the spotlight of the big stage, the supporting cast watch on from various parts of the stadium, including Adam Kwasnik, a grand final survivor from 2 years ago, who's unable to take the field due to a season-ending injury.
Easy.
It hasn't dampened his passion for his teammates.
Well done, Mikey.
Oh, boom! F***ing hell, man.
Oh, touch, Millet.
Hey!
Yes, Maka. Oh, balls! F***ing! What was that? That's two now. Two calls.
For Kwasnik, a pioneer mariner, spectating is a difficult pill to swallow.
Oh, look, it was tough. You know, I sort of, the week before the grand final, I had a good chat with Hutch, you know, over coffee, and, you know, explained my feelings to him. And, you know, I was really riding the team at the time because I really wanted the club to win the grand final. And I thought this season, the way, you know, we played and the way we were coached, you know, we absolutely deserved to win it.
Hey?
How hard is it sitting up here?
It's...
Mate,
I'd rather just be out. I'd be more relaxed out there.
Yeah.
Hey, yeah, but I'm shaking. Yeah. Time goes slow as well.
Adam Kwasnik will likely get a second chance in the future. While off the bench, Mitchell Duke is about to get his first.
Make sure you slide, because what they try and do to us, yeah? Wide free kicks, you're on the ball, tell Mikey number two.
Get Fitzy. Get Fitzy.
Get Fitzy quick.
Get Fitzy. Fitzy, right hand side. Yeah. Mate, they've gone to a back three. Mack has got to stay in midfield. You've got to defend out wide.
And 90 minutes almost up. It's not won quite yet. And here's Labano Haliti with a chance. Down he goes inside the box. And again, Peter Green waves play on. Not interested.
Get ready. Now look.
You've got a minute to go.
After an eight-year wait, the Mariners are within seconds of reaching their inaugural grand final success. History has taught them not to celebrate until it is over. As a result, the coaches stay stoic and focused until the very end.
That's time, bud.
Paused. It honestly felt like the world just fell off my shoulders. It was like an absolute relief that we finally won a grand final.
The emotions were feelings that I'll never forget. It was absolutely fantastic. It was like a massive relief. I think for the fans more than anything, they've endured so much heartbreak in the Mariners' history.
In 3 short years, Graham Arnold has delivered the club a premiership, second place, and a championship trophy. But for now, it's all about sharing the moment with his team.
At full time, it was more relief for the club, for the supporters and for the players. You know, the players, 90% of those players went through heartbreak. You know, all good judges and all good people say that you have to lose one before you win one. And we found the hardest way to lose one in 2011, seeing John Hutchinson and, you know, and Alex Wilkinson and those type of guys laying on the field at Suncorp, devastated.
Few will begrudge, I'm sure, the Mariners this moment.
They cried tears of despair 2 years ago. Today, it is tears of joy. They are the smallest club with the biggest hearts. So how good is it to finally proclaim that the Central Coast Mariners are the champions of Australia?
To see them actually, you know, have the opportunity to celebrate, because not everyone in wins a grand final in their career, and a career takes, you know, 10 or 12 years in football. It doesn't take 30 or 40 years to reach your goals.
It was a great moment to be a part of for the region, for the Central Coast, to achieve something like that on a national stage. I think it has been duly recognised since then, and I hope people don't forget the magnitude of what this club achieved on that scale.
We did it!
It was just a magic moment for everybody, and you know, I knew that was a massive part of what we'd done this, you know, that season. So for me, you know, I celebrated as much as everybody did.
Once that final whistle went, I wasn't sure what to do, you know. Like, obviously I wasn't out there, you know, I was sitting on the sidelines and I was watching the crowd and they were going berserk, and I wasn't sure whether to go out on the pitch, but I ended up doing so, and once I was out there and just embracing all the boys, it was an unbelievable feeling, and like I said, it was a night that I'll never ever forget.
And then the moment that many Central Coast fans had dared to dream about finally comes true.
Yeah, first and foremost, I was just so happy for the boys. As everyone knows, I've been in three grand finals before. And just to see them win the grand final, and the relief on the faces of all the boys and the fans, it was just great for the club.
As the trophy cools off in the hands of the victors, there is a significant outpouring of emotion from those within reach of the playing group. Family, fans, and former players are sharing in the relief and joy of burying the ghosts of the past. Mariners' story is one that transcends sport. Unlikely heroes in a tale that gives reason to pause for celebration, but also reflection. Taking time to acknowledge and respect the players and coaches of the past who have built a foundation and legacy that has made this victory possible. Arnold and his squad have done their time, weathering storms that the larger, wealthier clubs are immune to. The Mariners, despite the heavy sentiment, had to earn their victory today. And for now, that's all that matters.
are champions, and we are champions. We 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 are champions, and we are champions.
Boys and families, 3 years in the making. 3 years in the making this was. We've worked extremely hard, first and foremost. We've been through difficult times in the whole club. But, as we've said for quite a while, you have to lose one to win one. And you're an exception, Hutch, you lose three. We lost in the worst possible way. The first year that I was here against Brisbane, but I always knew in this squad there was a lot of faith and a lot of character, and we'd always fight back. I'm so proud of you all. Yeah.
So I just want to say, from the board of directors, from the shareholders, I mean, we couldn't be happier. You know, what you've delivered tonight is just a dream come true for all of us. It's a dream come true for the region. We've been called, you know, the little club that could, and the smallest market, the smallest club, but every year, you know, we just wipe them away.
People write that we're chokers. That's, you know, you've played three grand finals in, you know, in 7 years before this, and it's a totally different group of players that played in different grand finals, and, you know, two different coaches, and that was a motivation for us. So thank you. We've had a tough time over the past, but we've always stuck together. We've worked hard. It's always a pleasure to go to work with these boys every day, and. The focus of the week was to stick to the game plan and to nullify what they do best, and that's their transition to attack. And I thought that we carried that out perfectly tonight.
The Mariners' time in the sun is shared by the Central Coast and its loyal fans. As the only regional team in the A-League competition, it provides a unique moment that few cities experience. On this sunny afternoon in April, the entire coast comes to a standstill. These faces will not represent the Mariners again, and over the coming months, some will depart Australia's shores to continue their football adventure. Eyes will soon turn to the coming season. New recruits will join the ranks. Plans will be set in motion to defend the trophy, and these scenes will soon fade into history. But they will never be forgotten. And it will be forever written in the history of the A-League that, as commentator Simon Hill declared, its smallest club with the biggest heart were finally rewarded with a championship in 2013.